Saga Cigars, makers of the Saga Golden Age. The Golden Age is a cigar that takes you back to the classic days of cigar smoking. Through the six generations of experience by the Reyes family, the Saga Golden Age delivers a timeless blend that uses the nobility of the tobacco to bring you the perfect balance of power and flavor. It narrates better than words the history of a family's tradition in tobacco, delivering a cigar much like the ones they used to smoke in the times of Hemingway. Saga Golden Age is a full-bodied, full-flavored Dominican Puro. With tobaccos from one farm, the blend features a Corojo 2006 wrapper and filler from original Cuban seeds grown in the Dominican Republic. Available in four sizes at an affordable price, the Saga Golden Age is sure to please and take you back on a journey to yesterday. By Rocky Patel Premium Cigars, the sun-grown Maduro is hand-rolled at Rocky Patel's boutique factory in Esteli, Nicaragua. This triple-capped, hand-bunched, and hand-rolled cigar is accompanied by a gorgeous broadleaf wrapper. Well-balanced, rich, and decadent, it truly is a great addition to any humidor and worthy of bearing the long-respected sun-grown name. For more information, visit them on the web at rockypatel.com and be sure to follow Rocky Patel Premium Cigars on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram.
Welcome back to the Stogie Geek Show, episode 208 on this November 7th, 2016. Will Cooper from Studio C in North Carolina. Tonight, joined by the cigar surgeon, John Reiner, as our special guest co-host. Paul should be back next week. We have Mark and Riley up at the Bilger North America Studios, manning the controls. We're going to get our Stogies of the Week. You know, John, what are you smoking right now? Are you still smoking the Foundry, or have you got something else?
I didn't have a backup cigar. I should have planned a little bit better. I forgot how long the segments run. I really enjoyed that Foundry, and I haven't smoked it in probably, I want to say, a month and a half, 2 months. And it's always nice coming back to that cigar and sort of remembering. And we talked about that with Justin, is there's some components within the flavor profile there that are so interesting. And I love getting a cigar that has some components that I love, like that you talked about the chocolate, but then having some other components that I don't get in another smoking blend. Very enjoyable. So I kind of blew through that, and I enjoyed every minute of it.
No, I get that. I'm actually smoking. I lit up a cigar. It's called the Don Jorge Maduro. Have you ever heard of this cigar?
I have not.
I have not either. So this past weekend, I had a great opportunity to co-host Smooth Draws Radio in Atlanta. Which I'll tell you what, doing radio, it's completely different than doing this.
Totally different.
I have so much respect for what those guys do. You know, I got to hang out with Michael Turner, the NFL running back, who's actually one of the co-hosts of that show.
Oh, wow.
And he is a cigar. He's not just a guy that – he is a boutique. He's a cigar geek, this guy. We are making arrangements to get him as a guest on the show. But these guys gave me this cigar. And I kind of looked at it, and I'm like – I didn't know. I had never heard of it. And I didn't want to light up. I had another cigar here, which was just too big to light up for the show. I lit this up. This is a fantastic cigar. I don't know anything about it, by the way. So, you know, I apologize for not being prepared, but I'm gonna find out a little more about this cigar, because very, very interesting cigar. But this is our Stogies of the Week. And John, I always love doing this segment with you too. And I know, so I'll let you want to kick it off?
Sure, we'll kick it off. And this is probably one of my favorite segments of the show. I mean, I love Stogie News, you know, get that quick hit of Stogie News. But Stogies of the Week is really interesting from the perspective of getting a couple different thoughts on a cigar. Maybe I disagree with it, maybe I agree with it, but it's always interesting to find out what's being smoked. And I've had the opportunity to go through a lot of cigars, A, because I've been on the road for the last 6 weeks, and B, because, you know, I had to get my reviews in, as you guys do. And sometimes you got to get, you know, a few, you might be doing reviews all week long just to keep your schedule up to date. So I'll kick it off with a new one to me. And this is from Baracoa Cigars, called The Voyage. Have you tried this cigar yet, Coop?
I have it in my possession. I have not tried it yet. And what appeals to me about that cigar is it's coming out of La Aurora, and I've gotten to kind of communicate with Danny Vasquez. And we're going to get Danny on the show probably in December or January for sure. What I love about that cigar, it has a Columbus theme to it. So, and I'm a big Columbus Day fan. So I'm interested to hear about this.
So this is a great example, and you know, I'm not going to make it negative, but this is kind of one of the great things I love about the industry that's kind of being taken away, is that you've got a guy new to the industry with a, in terms of a brand new blend and brand new line in the market. And I love to see a guy fresh out of the gate absolutely kill it. And, you know, you're talking about smoking this cigar you've never heard of. I tend to try and smoke these cigars when I do a review as blind as possible. I don't want to let any of the blend or the tobacco sort of influence my mind. So I kind of smoke it and then look it up afterwards. And I got to tell you, and I'm going to be all over the from the Stogies of the Week, I'm going to be all over the market from the box worthy all the way down to a try one. This one is a box worthy. And it was a box worthy from the moment I lit it up till the moment I finished it. And the whole time I was thinking, here's yet another guy, first release, and he absolutely knocks it out of the park.
That's a great story. You know, like I said, I didn't get to spend a lot of time with Danny at the trade show. And if you feel bad because you can't get to everybody. Mm-hmm. I kind of got the message with him back and forth. I saw the passion he had with the Save the Leaf. I mean, this is a guy you want to make it. And I'm so glad Absolutely. To hear that cigar. And I love what comes out of La Aurora, too. So
me too.
So that's a great thing to hear about. And I know Danny's based in the Maryland area. And a lot of folks say, where can you get the cigars? I believe, you know, if you're in the Maryland, Virginia area, I believe a lot of stores are starting to carry that right now.
Yeah, I'd absolutely think it's got a broad appeal. It's about smack dab in the medium strength level. I think the flavor profile is outstanding. It's not going to be too complex if you're not used to really complex cigars. I don't think it's in that realm, but it's fantastically blended. And like I said, from the moment I lit it up to the moment I nubbed it, excellent cigar. It didn't waver at any point.
No, I agree. I haven't smoked it, but I would agree. You know, that's what I look for in a cigar, I should say.
Absolutely. What do you got, Coop?
All right. So I'm going to go and I'm going to, I have a cigar from Nomad Cigar Company, called the Martial Law. And, I'll put a commercial out there. Fred Rui is our scheduled guest for next week. And I'm really anxious to talk to him more about this, release. So, you know, Fred's expression is be nowhere, be anywhere. So he's kind of gone to different factories in different countries. And he kind of, now he's part of what was House of Emilio, now Boutiques, Unified. And earlier this year, Boutique Unified brought in the Black Label Trading Company and Blackwork Studio brands under their portfolio. So they're kind of like sister brands. What's unique about the Blackworks and the Black Label Trading Company is they have the Fabrica Oveja Negra factory, which is their own factory. And it probably provided opportunities for some of the other brands to, you know, utilize that factory. And Fred's taken advantage of that. So this is a new factory. He's using the Black Label Trading Company at Fabrica Oveja Negra factory. It's a cigar. It's a Habano wrapper over, Fred loves those Habano wrappers. He's got a Jalapa binder.
Yep.
Jalapa binder, Nicaraguan filler, a 6x50 Toro. Fred tends to produce a lot of Toros as well. I saw the price point at $12 and I was like, I kind of did a because Fred doesn't normally have the cigars over $10. Yep. Fred gave me one of these at the show. I liked it a lot. I didn't review it from the show because I just don't review show cigars, but I did get a few more of these afterwards. And I'll tell you what, I like Fred's stuff a lot, and I find that Fred's stuff ages really well with time, but sometimes it needs that time to age. This cigar comes along and right out of the gate, it's fantastic. I've got them and smoked them right away, and I'm like, normally, I didn't go through my normal waiting period, and this is a really, really good cigar. It's a bolder offering, I think, than Fred's got, you know, in his lines. I think this is more of a cigar. It's a, you know, it's a medium to full strength cigar. It's a medium to full body. That's full bodied. I think it kind of goes out there. It's got a little bit of a spicy kick to it, but it's not one of these overly complex cigars that's going to do a lot of flavor transitions. But it's a good cigar. The flavor is just really, really. Come to, you know, just play well together at all this. And, you know, for a $12 cigar, I got what I wanted out of this $12 cigar. I like what James Brown, who's the owner of Black Label Trading Company, is doing with his factory. I think this was a home run for Fred. I think this is one of his best regular production lines and or smaller production. But, I mean, it's an ongoing reason. I gave this one a box worthy as well.
And I'd have to absolutely echo that. This is one of those cigars, and I reviewed it, I think, about a month ago. And this is one of those cigars where I got, again, about an inch in, and I found myself on the internet looking for where I could have a box shipped to me when I was down in the States. And I picked up a box. And again, what I like about this, and it's not a 10 count. It's like a 12 count. And it's in an unusual packaging. It's kind of that long, skinny box, which is a bit of an unusual presentation. But that's, to me, the hallmark of a great cigar is I'm only partway into the experience. And I'm already saying, where can I buy a box of these? And I did. And yeah, I echo that 100%.
That's great. John, what else do you have this week?
Next up, switching up from sort of the medium full, we go into the Connecticut line. And this is, again, Rocky Patel, like a lot of companies, had a lot of new releases at the market. And, you know, I know Rocky's got a pretty broad profile. This was in the Connecticut line. And I think this is a cigar that's probably going to appeal to a lot of the Connecticut shade smokers out there. I know Paul should probably be looking at this cigar. It's the Rocky Patel Catch 22.
Now, oh, wow, this is the new Connecticut he has out.
This is the new Connecticut he has out. Now, I'll preface it by saying I'm not a morning Connecticut smoker. I do enjoy Connecticuts, but that's not where my profile normally lands. Unbelievable construction, unbelievable burn. What I found was curious about this, and you can probably speak to this, is it was the first Rocky Patel cigar I picked up, and it did not have Rocky Patel badging on it anywhere. There was no RP, there was no Rocky Patel. It just stood on its own as a Catch 22, which I found kind of interesting. And you can see the sort of design of the band fits within the Rocky Patel profile, but it had Rocky Patel nowhere to be found. Now, I rated this one a fiver, and again, I think that's more of my personal bias towards Connecticut's, but if you're a Connecticut smoker, I think there's a lot of people that can go nuts, not only because it's a great size, it's a great presentation, but the MSRP on this, $475.
Yeah, I mean, he had the original, I think there's a Habano offering in that as well. The one thing, I do believe Hamlet Cigar doesn't have the RP banding on it either.
That's true. Yep, that's true.
Right, but yeah, it is an interesting model that he was going to with that, and you know, he's going for, you know, he didn't have that that lower price cigar point, you know, in there, and that's the whole idea of the Catch 22, is they're going to deliver you a really good cigar at a really good price. We have Rocky Patel. I recorded an interview with Rocky Patel. It's going to air on the November 21st show. And I did discuss this cigar with him, actually. So, yeah, nice. Because they did a lot of Connecticut this year as well. There was, the Prohibition's got a Connecticut coming out. So there was the Howitzer in the Edge line. Now it's called Edge Connecticut because I can't call it Edge Light. But yeah, so that's a 7x70 in there. So definitely a push with Connecticut with Rocky this year.
What else do you have, Coop?
So this is one that is kind of one of those, I'd say, sequel cigars, but it's the Hoya Black by Hoya de Nicaragua.
Yeah. Now you're talking my language.
Yep. So again, if you watched I did an interview with Dr. Cuenca back in May. I smoked this on the show. Liked it a lot, but when you smoke it on a show, you really don't get much out of it. But these have hit the market. And the Hoya line, they kind of did a few interesting things with the Hoya line. It's kind of their more modern, contemporary Hoya de Nicaragua. The irony is, for the contemporary smoker, what they're doing is they're actually introducing blends that are more dialed back, which I find interesting. While their traditional stuff, like the 1979 Antonio, is their powerhouse stuff. And normally it's the other way around. They go for the modern modern brand tends to go for the powerhouse. This is the first Hoya branded cigar with Mexican San Andreas. And I think it's important to know is Hoya's worked with San Andreas before. My Uzi weighs a ton. Is a San Andreas. It's made at Hoya. Fratello Bianco, made with San Andreas. So they've used it, but not on their own cigar. And they went and did this. This is kind of a sibling offering to the Hoya Red. As opposed to Hoya Red, which is a Nicaraguan Puro, I'd say that's more of a mild to medium. This is more of a classic medium cigar. It's not gonna be a radically different San Andreas cigar. It's got good flavor. I did enjoy the flavor. I did find in that last third, it gave me that San Andreas pungency, which I'm kind of critical of. But for the first two thirds, it was really good. You look at a price point for, and I smoked the Toro here, price point of $8, very reasonable. I gave it a box split. I think there was still enough with this cigar, very well made cigar, where nice complimentary offering to the Hoyer Red.
Yeah, I'm on the same page. I rated it a box split as well, and I think this cigar, I look at this cigar as having some great aging potential because of the tobaccos that Hoya used, and you nailed it, Coop. You know, they blend back from full-bodied. Like, the lowest, the Hoya Red was such a shock because, you know, the lightest thing you could get in the, well, other than the Cabanetta series, was really a medium full cigar because they blend for flavor and strength, and that's what they blend for. And, you know, that Hoya Black is just smack dab in the middle, and a lot of people might say, well, you know, there's lots of medium body, medium strength cigars in the market. Yes, but this is that great offering where it takes San Andreas Maduro and puts it together with the great Hoya tobacco. So if you're a fan of Hoya cigars, this is one you're going to want to seek out. And I suspect that when we come back and revisit this in, you know, 4, 5, 6 months, I think this cigar might have a lot of aging potential on it.
I agree. That was kind of like my, you know, especially sometimes a little pungency at the end that could eventually fade away with some age. So I agree. But there was a lot of, I mean, and I saw a difference smoking this cigar now that when I smoked it with when I interviewed Dr. Cuenca, it was an unbanded sample. So I definitely saw this cigar mature. You know, probably when I smoked it, if I would have commanded, I said a fiver, which is a very good rating for us, but I think it's gone up to that box split level. And I think it's, does Hoya have another true Maduro offering in their line?
Oh boy, that's a good question because they do. I mean, they've been in the market for 47, 48 years now. They've got a lot of profile, and I'm kind of racking my brain.
I was just thinking about that. I mean, the Cuatro Cinco really wasn't a Maduro.
No. An outstanding cigar, but yeah.
Dark wrapper. So, yeah, you know, I kind of. They've done Maduros. Again, like I said, they did the Portello Bianco, the Mayo Z weighs a ton, but yeah.
But not within their own brand. Yeah.
Yeah. Yep.
So one of the interesting ones for me, and someone who had to miss the IPCPR, really focusing on his brand and you know, making sure that there are blends out there for everyone can smoke, Robert Holt of Southern Draw. And I think you guys did a review of this. This is the Code Duelo, and I smoked this in the Kudzu. Now, I didn't have someone to smoke it with, so I was only smoking one of the two. What's interesting, there's two things that are interesting. First of all, it comes as a two-pack, and it's really designed to be sold as a two-pack and shared, and I like that. I like when a cigar manufacturer comes out with packaging that, you know, innovates and pushes the marketplace. It's an interesting concept, and I won't go into it because it's long. But essentially, the purpose of this is to resolve conflicts. And this is really a great time when we talk about the election series being tomorrow. This is a great cigar that you might want to sit down with someone and hash out your differences with a cigar. The construction on all of his cigars are fantastic. I hadn't previously had the Kudzu blend, but it's got that great box press to it. Burn is great. Construction is great. And this is another one I rated as a box worthy. Now, I know they're sold this in a two-pack release, but, you know, this is a box worthy cigar all day long. Enjoyed it from start to finish. And it was one of those cigars where you're partway doing your review and you've kind of forgotten about where you are and what you're doing. And to me, if your cigar can just take you so out of your headspace and focus on the cigar, that's a great experience from start to finish.
Did you smoke the 5x58 or the 6x56?
It was the 5x58. And I think we talked about box press. What I love about box press, 58 is probably way out of my wheelhouse for size for Vitola. But when you box press it, that 58 really smokes like it's a 54, maybe even a 52 to me.
Yeah, I agree. And in fact, what was pretty cool is Robert came to Charlotte and we actually did it's funny, he handed me one, we did the duel right in a cigar store. And, nice. You know, it was a lot of fun. He actually put it on Facebook Live. And Paul and I actually afterwards, we did a segment on dueling cigars for Stogie Geek Shorts as well, because it was kind of a cool concept. And what better way tomorrow than to, you know, like I said, have a cigar with someone and, you know, forget about this other stuff. I mean, you know, keep your friends, you know. You know,
yep.
It's funny. I'll just say, you know, Tuna, right?
Yep.
Tuna and I probably disagree a lot on politics. We haven't had one fight about this. We've been having a ball talking about this like on a daily basis. I mean, it's just that's kind of the way we've never attacked one another. You know, he went to one rally, I went to another rally, and it's been fun. And I'm kind of gonna miss this when the election's over. we've turned it into more of a fun thing. So, but funny you mentioned, because I have a Southern Draw cigar too. I have the Southern Draw Firethorn Pomme Lancero. So this is Robert Hall came out with some Lancero line extensions across his portfolio. The Firethorn line is his Rosado line, while the Kutsu is his Oscuro line. It's got a San Andreas, so it's got a Habano Rosado wrapper, San Andreas binder, Nicaraguan filler, and this is a 6.5x40. Now, I love the Firethorn line by Robert. I think that is a really, really good cigar. This is Belle of the Ball in the Firethorn line.
Wow.
This is again, we talked at the beginning of the show, big year for Lanceros. This was a big Lancero. I think this is one of the best cigars that Robert's done to date. It keeps to the characteristics of the Firethorn blend. It has its like fruity sweetness, a little bit of baker spice, a little bit of caramel toast in there. It may sound like it's a dessert, but there's a lot of tobacco. there's a lot of tobacco qualities to this thing too. Belle of the Ball for sure. Box worthy. Definitely check out this cigar by Southern Draw. I think Robert is again one of the good guys in the industry as well. So it was really good. This is probably my favorite one. I actually gave the Cold Duelo a box split, which isn't too far off either. So for the same size, so I think we're pretty much in agreement that that's a very good release.
So talking about Lanceros, we'd be remiss not talking about the hot new broadleaf, which is Nick Melillo's foundation company, the Tabernacle, but in a Lancero.
I haven't smoked this one.
Well, let me tell you, smoke it on a full stomach.
Wow.
Because Nick did not pull any punches. Now, the other cigar that I've smoked, and we've talked about it, but I'm going to talk about it again. The Protocol Lancero is probably one of the strongest Lanceros I've ever smoked. Quadruple Lajero, but still managed to be elegant and nuanced. The Tabernacle does not pull any punches. This is, I think, the cigar that people were expecting Nick to come out with back when he hit the market with the Huehuense. This is the cigar I think people were expecting, and it delivers across the board. You do not want to smoke this cigar if you avoid full-bodied cigars. This is a full-bodied cigar, and it doesn't let up for the entire smoking experience. Now, I rated this one a box split with an asterisk because I feel like it does have a little bit of young quality in the sense that it's so strong and the tobaccos in it are so prominent that I feel like they haven't kind of found their right mesh, the right balance. And I feel like this is a cigar that after 8 or 10 months of aging, this one could kick it up to a box buy, maybe even a Fight Chuck Norris, because I've never in my life had a Lancero that delivered this much power. And it was an excellent smoking experience from start to finish. But make no mistake, you are getting on the Bronco, and the Bronco is taking you for a ride for the smoking experience.
Excellent. I got to smoke that one. I have a feeling that Tabernacle is going to be on a lot of people's lists this year.
Absolutely.
I have not reviewed it yet. But yeah, I have to definitely review that cigar. And now I have to try the Lancero as well. I have smoked it. It's a very good line.
Because Robbie smoked the Tabernacle and the Toro, and he got a very different experience. I think the Toro, he said, was a much more balanced, much more dialed back. So I was quite surprised because, you know, again, you have to use less tobaccos in the Lancero. I was very surprised to see just how strong that Lancero was. I'd be really interested to read your thoughts on that.
Yeah, no, I got to now definitely give that one a shot as well. All right, so I'm gonna go completely do a 180 here.
All right.
And I'm going to talk about a 6.25x68 ring gauge cigar.
Oh my goodness.
This is the Flor de Crassier Enormous 360 Oscuro.
I've been waiting for someone to talk about this cigar.
Yeah. So I got these cigars, disclaimer, pre-August 8th. So they've been sitting for a while. This is DeCrossier, who is Santana Diaz's brand, who is distributed by Espinosa Cigars. Santana's done 60 ring gauges before, and he's done very good with them. But this is now he's kind of going into that Super Gordo market. So he's trying to go against the Asylums, obviously, with the AP Corral Inch. So he released these two blends called the Enormous 360. One is a Claro and one is an Oscuro. They're different blends and actually two different, completely different sizes. So the Oscuro is that 6.25 by 68, and the Claro is actually 6 1/8 by 65. He doesn't talk much about the blend other than it's using a Costa Rican Oscuro wrapper. He says there's three, I'm not disputing this, but I'll tell you why I'm kind of phrasing it that way. He says there's three Ligeros in this blend, okay? You look at this cigar, it's an oily, dark cigar, right?
Yeah.
And I'm expecting this thing to be a bomb, right? It is not. It is not. It is, in fact, this is a cigar that I felt was mild to medium in strength and body for most of the cigar experience.
Now, did you smoke the Claro or the Oscuro?
The Oscuro.
Wow.
The Oscuro. I did not expect this to be a dial-back cigar. This is, and I smoked through several of these, okay? In fact, on my way back from Atlanta, I had written a review, and I said, you know what? I wanted to, again, I wanted to kind of check myself to see if I was kind of in space, right?
Yeah.
Now there is a nicotine kick at the end of the cigar. So it goes to, so it's going to have more strength at the end where it's more of a medium. But the body's very dialed back. But the thing is, the dialing back of that body works with this cigar. I mean, it's just it has wonderful, wonderful flavors. It's, you know, classic coffee, earth notes. There's some pepper, but again, the pepper's not in there. There's some nice sweet cocoa you're gonna get from this. It's a really good cigar. The burn wasn't perfect on these things, I'll be honest with you. It wasn't a bad burn, but, you know, it needed a little more. It was a very thick wrapper on this thing. It's a pricey cigar, though. It's $17, okay?
Ooh.
It's a pricey, but you get a lot of cigar for $17.
Absolutely.
So I kind of gave it the box split based on the price point. I thought it was worthy of something better than a fiver. Had this been like a $10 cigar, it would have been a box-worthy cigar. But $17.20, it is a higher price point. It's a cigar that's interesting because I haven't had a big ring gauge like anything like this before. So it's very different. But the dial-back profile worked with this cigar. I think if it was heavy flavors on the palate, it would not have been an enjoyable cigar. It had a clean finish, and I think that worked in favor of this. I advise it.
Sorry, but I was going to say, now that you're talking about that, I'm going to have to seek it out, because when we're talking to Santana at the show, he was talking about this thing being just absolutely blow you away in terms of nicotine strength. And to hear you talk about it, I know you're not normally a guy who likes overly nicotine cigars. So that's really an interesting take on that cigar.
I didn't take that with him. I heard the same thing, and he did see the review. But there is a nicotine hit at the end of this cigar. There's no doubt that in that last third, it ramps up, but it kind of doesn't really get out of the medium range. But because the flavors are dialed back, I think you feel more strength on this cigar, if that makes sense. Because
yep.
it's longer
experience.
Yeah, so I just didn't get that, and I could be wrong. I'm waiting to see someone else review it and prove me wrong. But I like the cigar, is what I'm just saying. I that's why I went and smoked this thing. I stopped at a lake on the way back, driving back from Georgia, where nice, quiet place. I wasn't disturbed. And I'm like, no, it's not kicking past that. So I just went with the review at that point.
And what was your rating on that?
Box split.
Box split. Wow.
If it was a little cheaper, I would have went box worthy. But it was better than a fiver. I kind of felt it was better than a fiver. I would definitely, it's one of my favorite 60 plus ring gauge cigars I've ever had. So I'll say he really knocked it out of park. Yeah, he knocked it out of the park. I enjoy 60 ring gauges. When you get above that, I tend not to. This one is probably one of the better ones I've had.
Okay. Now, going back to some of the new offerings in general, one of the new offerings we're talking about, Jack is back with Terrano, and they've kind of gone through a portfolio reblend, repackaging, and one of the cigars that I, you know, still have in my humidor is the Terrano Gold. I think it's the 1959. I really enjoy that cigar. So I had the Terrano Exodus. It's an enjoyable cigar, but I'm going to say it feels a little bit safe in the sense that I think this cigar has a really broad market appeal. It wasn't blended for the boutique smokers out there. It was really blended for this sort of everyday cigar smoker. So I would say, you know, I enjoyed this cigar. It had a lot of really nice flavors that, you know, typically I would get out of Terrano, but it didn't have anything that sort of made it rise above what I've had from Terrano in the past. So I rated it a fiver with caveat that I think, you know, even though I rated a fiver, I think on the marketplace, this cigar is going to do really well, especially with the new repackaging.
I did smoke it. When I did smoke it, I felt it needed a little more time. This is back in probably early September. So I did think it needed a little more time, but I think there's some potential with it. I did smoke some of the new vaults, and the new vaults, again, for the price point of $550, they're really good. I know the Camacho packaging.
Vaults, yeah.
I get it with the Camacho packaging. Jack was very open on the show about that. So I do get that. But at the same time, I really felt it was I really felt those cigars delivered some value too. So I think, like I said, the Exodus, I'm giving it a little more time with that, and I'm gonna definitely revisit it. I probably had it somewhere where I try one or five, but I think, like I said, I could tell it needed a little time to sit.
Fair enough. So what do you got up, Coop?
Nestor Miranda Collection Maduro Robusto.
Oh, yeah.
Kind of was going back to the Nestor Miranda Collection with the whole, they added the Corojo, right? So I wanted to kind of go back and smoke the Nestor Miranda Collection. That's the broadleaf offering. And I've smoked it in the Dano size, which is a 7x56. Here I smoked the 4.5x50 Robusto. So it's this Connecticut broadleaf offering. Classic Connecticut broadleaf is what I'll say. It's not. It's kind of got a little bit of that Don Pepin, because the Garcias make it. So you get that Don Pepin black pepper hit at the beginning. But you're going to get those classic Maduro sweetness, which I kind of, it's a little bit of dried fruit with a little bit of that coffee tobacco taste in there. There was a little bit of a bitterness, actually, but I felt the bitterness actually balanced the blend out pretty well. So sometimes, you know, we talk about that bitterness is not necessarily a bad thing on a cigar. It's not overpowering. It's about a medium to full. Again, I think I would prefer this. I think the Dano size was better, but this was still solid enough at a $750 price point. I'd probably put a fiver in it. I'd pick some of these up at an event. And I think, you know, it could do well.
Nice. Going back to Rocky Patel, because I smoked a few Rocky Patels, and we kind of talked about this one offline previously, the Rocky Patel 55, and I smoked the short one, and I can't remember the Vitola name they gave it, but it's a very unusual Vitola. It's a 4.5x55, and they made all the blends within this, a 55 ring gauge, and they go all the way up to, I think, the big bad boy is a 7.5x55, and Rocky talks about it in the interview, and I talked to Hamlet about this. They had to have custom molds commissioned for this project, and really the project was to commemorate Rocky Patel's 55th birthday. Now, when I hear something like that, I go, well, you know, sometimes in the past, some of those commemorative projects have kind of missed, you know, they've kind of had this big fanfare or this special thing they've done for them, and you smoke the cigar and you're like, yeah, it's a fiver, it's not bad, but like, you know, the way it was talked up, it was supposed to be great. This is the exact opposite. From the very start that I started up this cigar, I would say that right now, for me, this is probably the best cigar in all of Rocky Patel's portfolio. And I say that as a lover of, the Edge. I love the Tabacaro, which I feel like the Tabacaro is a separate brand. So this is kind of just talking about Rocky's general available blends. The 55, and I'll have to try in the other sizes, but in this 4.5x55, rocked my socks. It had, like, I was all over the flavor map, from chocolate to espresso to coffee to cream and back again. And the smoking experience was great because it was about an hour and 10 minute smoking time, which is really nice for a small cigar. No issues with burn, no issues with draw. And I rated this a box worthy. I think that this might actually be one of those cigars where because I'm picking up a box, I might revisit this in the new year and come back to it. This could go up to a Fight Chuck Norris.
Wow.
Because, yeah, it was that good.
I have smoked it. I smoked the little one.
Yes.
So I smoked
that. The little guy.
And it's interesting because he's got something like a very small little petite one. I want to say it's about 4 inches or so. All the way up to like eight.
That was the one I smoked.
So you smoked the little one.
I smoked the little tiny guy, yeah.
Yeah, and then they have a big one. Like I said, I think it's like an 8-inch one.
Yeah, it's like 8x55. It's still 55 ring gauge, but oh my gosh, 8 inches by 55 ring gauge. I mean, that's a smoking commitment.
I was a little confused with the blend on that. I know it was on the band, but what was interesting, I know the way you described the blend in your review, I went back to the interview with Rocky, and he described it the same way. So I'm not sure why it was on the band the way it was. It's kind of where I'm going.
Yeah, no, and I agree with you. I think because I saw a few different interviews from a few different media companies and even our own video. So I went back to your video. I went back to your notes. I went to Half Wheel. I went to ours. And I think I ended up with 4 different videos and I literally got 4 different blends. So I had to go back to Hamlet and say, listen, you know, I don't want to post poor information. Can you kind of clarify this? And like you said, the blend's right on the band. So I'm not sure if maybe there's some miscommunication or maybe the blend changed before it got released. Cause maybe, you know, I don't know, but it works. It absolutely works.
You know, yeah, and when we have the interview with Rocky, and it was really interesting, is he's going to talk about, we asked him a lot about introducing all these blends, right? And he really gave an excellent thing. You know, he said there's just so much they want to share, you know, that and I bet you there was probably 2 of these things that they just had, and you know, maybe they just went with the other one at some point, you know, and it gives them something they can introduce as a line extension later on, you know, so... I think there's some benefit with that.
What do you got? What do you got rest left, Coop?
How many more you got left?
I can do 3 more, or I can do 1 more.
Okay, we can do a couple. We could probably go through these. I'll do my next one. This is a cigar by Regis. And I'm a big fan of Regis. I think they just one of the really good brands out there. This is the Regis Exclusivo USA Oscuro Especial in the Robusto size. One of those names.
A lot of words.
Let's just call it the blue label.
Okay.
So it's the Exclusivo USA line was introduced by Regis. And the idea was that, you know, when Regis came into the U.S. market, they come in with a profile, I think, that is more of a European type of profile. And they wanted to introduce some cigars that would appeal to American smokers. And I think they've come out with a red blend, which is a Nicaraguan Puro. They came out with a white blend, which is their Claro. But this one was a Maduro blend. And Akil Capisi, who is the owner of Regis, has done a Maduro before. It's called the Debaris. And one of the best Maduros I've had. He did it for like a very limited – I think SigFed had it for a short time as well. But it was very limited release. This is a more widespread release. It's a San Andreas Mexican wrapper, box press, Robusto. They have a bunch of the 6 sizes are all box pressed except for this size called the Fat Perfecto. I've talked to Akil. I've gotten to know him. He was really worried about releasing this cigar because Maduro is kind of something again. It's not something that's in his wheelhouse, you know. Yep. He's kind of so. This was like a personal challenge to him, and he was really wondering if he would hit the mark with this. Like, I think he did. I think this is a really smooth, creamy Maduro with that creamy chocolate notes. Again, that little Maduro sweetness I talked about earlier on. It's a really good box press. What I liked about this is it had none of that pungency that the San Andreas wrapper had. It's a cigar. It's not a very strong cigar either. It's a medium bodied cigar, and I say the first half of this is in the mild to medium range. So it's not a strong Maduro, and you don't see that with San Andreas. You know, the only other like dial back San Andreas Maduro I've had is Hammer and Sickles, the trademark Maduro.
Yep.
This got a little more pep to it, but I really, really like the cigar. $8.95 price point for a cigar, a Robusto size 4.5 by 52. It's going to smoke a little more almost into that Corona because, again, the box pressing did it. The other thing what I'll say is it's a very sharp box press. It's not one of the okay. which I was surprised from Akil because
yeah, I would have figured he'd go soft box press. Yeah,
and he's done some soft box presses, but again, I think he was kind of targeting something with the U.S. market here. Great cigar, box worthy cigar. This is one of the hidden cigars of the year, kind of one of the good finds I found this year, and I think it's my favorite of the red, white, and blue right now. Is that Blue Label?
Yeah, I think you know, Akil. I've never had a cigar from Akil that I haven't really enjoyed. So it doesn't, I mean, he's a very introspective guy. So it doesn't surprise me that he was worried about how the blend would turn out, but it also doesn't surprise me that you would rate this so highly because he does have a great palate for blending and all of his cigars that I've tasted in the past have been excellent.
Yeah. I mean, I'll be honest. I consider Akil a friend. We've gotten to know each other. I'll be honest with him as well on feedback with a cigar. So, I mean, this project I've known he released it earlier this year, and it was something he just, you know, he's a confident guy. He was a little less confident in this. I said, Akil, you did it with Damaris. Damaris was a top five cigar for me a few years ago.
Yeah.
This is a very different cigar than Damaris, is what I'll say. It's a little more dialed back, but I think he found something with this blend. I think this is something really a lot of people can enjoy this cigar.
I'm going to go in it. You're talking about 180 degrees. This is 180 degrees. So I'm talking about the Upsetters from Foundation Cigar Company. So we've talked, you know, in the past about the Charter Oak, the Waywense, the Tabernacle. This is a blend that I think surprised a lot of people when it hit the market because the description that we were kind of going with was Jamaican tobacco. And that kind of took me back to the Macanudo Jamaica Reserve, which to this day is, you know, both the first release and the follow-up release. I think they nailed it. It's such an interesting and unique cigar, and I did get some of the Jamaican tobacco elements in this cigar, but, and there's a caveat, you know, and I like, you know, I don't want people out there to think I don't like infused cigars, because I do like infused cigars. I smoke infused cigars, I smoke coffee infused, I smoke a lot of the range from Drew Estate, provided they're blended well, you know, they're very enjoyable. I think what ended up happening for me in this cigar, and I don't know if it's, because there is a wide range, he's got like, I think it's 5 or 6 different wrapper types across the line. I smoked the Dango, and for me, I think what happened was the infusion process, which comes across as very herbal, which is good, but it kind of overshadowed the tobacco for me, and I was really hoping to get some of the Jamaican tobacco out of the cigar, and instead what I got was largely that herbal component, which is fine, but it just overshadowed the Jamaican tobacco, and as a result, it ended up being a little one-dimensional for me. I rated this one a try one, but that said, you know, the portfolio is immense. He's got all these different wrapper types. He's got all these different sizes. And I feel like this is one, to be fair, because Nick does have an amazing palette for blending, that I need to come back and try one of the other wrapper types, one of the other sizes, and see how it performs versus the Dango that I smoked.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, there's a few of these I want to try as well. You know, that Candela one's the one I think I'm really pining to try right now.
That could be really interesting.
Yeah. What would you describe? You said you got some of the Jamaican tobacco quality. What would, for people who maybe haven't smoked a lot of it, what would you say is how would you describe that component?
Oh, I was afraid you're going to ask me that because, you know, I think they call it silver tongue or silver leaf.
That's what General use, something like that. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, Jamaica does have this long history of growing tobacco, and it's, you know, it's one of those tobaccos, like if you have Medio Tiempo tobacco from AJ Fernandez, you know, it's one of those tobaccos that there's nothing else quite like it on the market. It's not like a broadleaf. It's not like a San Andreas. It's not like a Corojo. So for me, it's interesting to come across a tobacco that's unique, and I can't even really describe, because unfortunately, again, I couldn't pick out the tobacco notes. When I had it on the Macanudo Jamaica Reserve, it had this sort of rich meatiness mixed with a savoriness mixed with almost a chocolate, but not chocolate combination, which I've never gotten out of tobacco before, and if I can smoke a cigar that has a tobacco that's unique and it brings all the blend together without standing out, that's great. I think he, you know, and I hope that within the other line offerings that Jamaican tobacco stands out, because it's not cheap. I think that tobacco is one of the most expensive tobaccos in the industry. So I really hope that one of the other blends maybe showcases that tobacco a little bit more than, for me, this Dango did.
Yeah, see, I couldn't describe it. That's why I was asking you. I'm being totally.
It's hard.
What I smoked was the Macanudo Jamaican releases, the Estate Reserves, and I felt it was a very small component that was in there of it. So I didn't quite get that much of that.
So what else you got up, Coop?
This is my last one. This is going back to Black Works Studio, James Brown. This is the Killer Bee Green Hornet Robusto.
Great cigar.
Have you had this, the Green Hornet?
So what's funny is I bought the Killer Bee and the Green Hornet thinking they were, I was tired, I was on the road, thinking they were two different lines, but they're just two different size offerings within that, and smoked them both. But I'm really interested to hear what your thoughts are on that.
No, they're two different blends. They're actually two different blends.
Oh, they are two different blends. Okay, good.
So the difference is, so Black Rock Studio, they're kind of doing, you know, I think Justin was talking about more of these artesian types of cigars. So what they have is, you know, if you saw the Killer Bee, it has those linear rings kind of around the cap of like natural tobacco on a dark wrapper.
Yeah.
What they did with Killer Bee Green Hornet is they instead of using the natural wrapper, they used candela. But with one other catch, they put a candela around the footer of the cigar, which, in my opinion, I think the blend is the same. Or similar. There is some tweaking from what James told me there. But it totally changes up that cigar from the beginning. So what you're going to get is, I called it a candela shot. You're going to get a classic candela shot of white pepper, grass, and herb to start. It's short. It's only about a quarter of an inch, so it's not going to last very long. And when it shifts right out of it. And then it moves to more of a Maduro type of cigar. And it does have some richness. I freaking love this cigar. I love that candela shot. It was like just enough for me. And then, but it is very candela-like. And then you won't get that for the rest of that cigar. Really, really. And I like the Killer Bee. And I kind of go back. The regular Killer Bee has some other quality. There's a little bit of a lemon rind note I get on this cigar, but I get that lemon rind note more on the regular Killer Bee. That being said, both, it's a box worthy cigar. And $9.50 for a cigar, you know, it's a smaller cigar. It's a Robusto size, but it's a small Robusto at 5x48. But really, like I said, for an artesian quality cigar, it just looks good and tastes good and is unique. I didn't think it was that bad a price point, considering I got something very different. So I went box worthy.
Yeah, I accidentally thinking I bought a single 5-pack in my checkout cart, picked 2 5-packs of each. And after smoking them, I'm smoking a few of each. I'm glad that I did. And I'm not really a big fan of too much candela, because I feel like candela is one of those wrappers where sometimes it doesn't even matter. Like, you could put Pennsylvania broadleaf in there and somehow candela runs that right over. And too much of that sort of grassy, it's like fresh cut hay in your mouth. And sometimes it's a little too much for me. I think you nailed it with the description. It just gives you that blast up front of candela, and then it's like someone slammed the door, because it's gone. When it's gone, it's gone. But it makes for a really interesting and unique smoking experience. And, you know, kudos for James for coming out with such an interesting blend when they've got so much interesting product on the market already.
Yeah, I mean, I gave him, you know, a lot of credit. But, you know, pickle juice, though, what Hector Alfonso did with that, that is uncandela-like. In fact, Paul liked it, but the problem is Paul was looking for, he does like the traditional candela. He's very much a fan. So he was looking more for that, but he recognized, too, it was something different. Now, the other one I'll say that's a very unique candela is, if you can get it, is the wasabi. Box press candela. It's a spicy candela is the best way to put it. It's a good cigar. But so they're two, you know, unique ones.
Okay. Finishing it up, another release, the last release from Nomad. And I feel like if this had been the sort of new hotness from Fred, I think it would have done really well for me. In a way, it was kind of overshadowed by the one we talked about earlier, the Martial Law, because the Martial Law for me is probably Fred's best blend to date. And
I agree. I agree.
Yeah. So, and I love, like, Fred, whatever Fred blends tends to be what I love for my palate. And, you know, I think if the Martial Law hadn't come out, you know, it's kind of one of those things where you got to pick a favorite kid, even though you don't want to. And this is the Nomad SA17. Now, I think Fred originally blended as a collaboration with the San Andreas Maduro, but this is the sort of first true regular release of him dealing with the San Andreas Maduro. And I know there's a lot of offerings in the market. I mean, we've talked about some of them tonight with the San Andreas Maduro wrapper, and maybe that kind of gets lost. But this is one of those cigars that it delivers. It's excellent. You're not necessarily going to get the same flavor change-ups as some of other releases from Fred, but I can tell you it was an excellent smoking experience from start to finish. And it, to me, was one of those cigars where I finished it and I wanted to light up another one. And I said, this is one of those cigars where I feel like it's almost got a permanent place in my humidor, where the moment I smoke through my bundle or box, that I'm going to go back and replenish it. As a result, I scored it a box worthy. I think if I had smoked this after I smoked the Martial Law, I would have been kind of comparing it to the Martial Law and maybe would have scored it a box split. But I think that would be unfair to this cigar. I think on its own, this is a cigar that's, you know, in the medium wheelhouse. If you like that San Andreas Maduro, it doesn't have that harshness in the end. In fact, I smoked this thing right till my fingertips were burning. I think this is going to appeal to a huge segment. And, you know, for those, you know, the Martial Law is not an inexpensive cigar. So I think this is a great alternative that still delivers a great smoke experience.
Yeah, you know, it's interesting. The SA-17, he did that out of Nicaragua. And I think he did that with AJ.
Yep.
He did that H-Town one is coming out of the DR, and the H-Town one was his first San Andreas.
Right, that's the one, yep.
Yeah, you know, and what's interesting, Fred is our guest next week, and this is the fourth time Fred has been on. We usually try to have our guests on about once a year. So Fred, when Paul and I merged and we decided to have guests on, Fred was like, I think, the first guest we lined up. And every year I've had him on, and his journey that he's gone on has been incredible. You know, he just was starting out the first year. The second year, he was starting to blend something more full-bodied. Last year, he had his first Maduro with the therapy. Now, this yep. year, he's done with a San Andreas and a Candela, as well as, you know, kind of gone to another factory. So I'm really looking forward to kind of catching up on the next step of that journey next year next week with that journey.
And to me, you know, I can't really play favorites in the marketplace because there's so many good cigars, but Fred is one of those guys where I've really enjoyed watching that journey, and I'm really excited to see, you know, what comes out in the marketplace in the future, because, you know, to me, he's delivered so many times in the past for my palate that I always look forward to what's next from Fred, even though, you know, I think in my humor, I think I have probably five different offerings from previous releases still in my humidor that I revisit on a regular basis.
Exactly. I totally agree with you on that.
Fantastic. Anyway. Well, that wraps it up for me.
Yep. Before we kind of wrap it up, I'll just kind of quick, I know we mentioned Fred is going to be on the November 14th show. November 21st, we have, actually, we're gonna play that Rocky Patel interview, as well as an interview. We're gonna have an interview with a gentleman from the coffee industry, Jay Caraguay, who we've had on before, and do some stuff around coffee. On November 28th, we have Omar De Frias on as well, and he's another one of those journey guys. We've had him on once a year.
Absolutely.
And then on my birthday, December 5th, will be Phil Zanghi. We just got confirmation from him on that. So. And then that if we get that Padron interview, that will probably be on. We don't have that one. We'll make sure I record that interview before we schedule it, but it'll be the week after. So, John, hey, man, thanks so much. This was a great show. Always thanks, appreciate you. It as well. That does it for episode 208 of Stogie Geeks. Thanks again to Justin Andrews. Be sure to check out all of our brands. You can watch the Stogie Geeks show on www.stogiegeeks.com. Stogie Geeks Shorts, www.stogieshorts.tv. Stogie Geeks News, the only podcast dedicated to cigar news, at www.stogienews.tv. And, of course, Cigar Cooper daily news and reviews at www.cigar-coop.com. Thanks, everybody.